Greetings, people from Bear's Planet. My name is Ronald, and I welcome you back to, I don't have a really named this place yet. But, welcome back to the channel. Let's just go with that. Yeah. Today we are not going to review a single malt. We are not going to review a whiskey or a bourbon, for that matter. We are going to talk about the differences between this guy and this guy. This is a bourbon, this is a scotch. They are both whiskies. The main difference is this one, a bourbon, needs to be distilled in the USA. And a scotch needs to be distilled in Scotland. Now, there are some exceptions and differences to the rules, of course. You always find that, especially with whiskey in general. This one is a Kentucky Straight Bourbon. To be called a Kentucky Straight Bourbon, we will get into that later. But to be called a Kentucky Bourbon, it needs to be distilled in Kentucky. Whoa, big surprise, I know. Well, first of all, let's talk about what is a whiskey, actually. Well, a whiskey is a distilled spirit from a grain mash, actually. And scotch needs to be from malted barley. There is, as far as I know, not really a rule to how much percent malted barley scotch distilleries should be using. For bourbon, there is. Bourbon needs to contain 51% corn. Not any less. More, of course. I have some notes here on the side. Of course, scotch also contains water and yeast, but that's basic knowledge. The other thing with bourbon, by the way, is it cannot contain color. This is a natural color. This is not natural, I believe, because it doesn't say meat fab stuff. Yes, this has color. This is a natural color. This doesn't. This one is more expensive, though. That's also the thing. Scotch, most of the time, is more expensive than bourbon. Why? Bourbon is young. Scotch needs to age at least 3 years and a day in oak casks. This one does not. You can throw it in. An hour later, get it out. It's a bourbon. Let's make some money. Nobody will buy it because it will be awful, of course. But, yeah. So, but these ones are both 12 years old. Priced fairly similarly. This one, a little bit more expensive than this one. This is about 30, 35. This one's about 40, 45. To sometimes 35. I also have port. Some whiskey. Can you guess what it is? I also added some water. There's a really nice nose. Which one? This one? Or this one? Nice. Let me scroll a little bit up my notes. There we go. Bourbon and scotch need to contain at least 40% ABV in alcohol. Most of the time, bourbons are higher, around 50, most of the time. This one's 47. This one is what? 40. So the minimum, the legal minimum of alcohol used in this bottle. And this one is cheaper, but it has more alcohol. Most of the time, you will find higher prices at higher ABV whiskeys, whether it's a bourbon or scotch. So, yeah, that's that. Okay. Okay. Yes, well, this is a nice little thing that I see on my notes here. I actually forgot it. That's why we have notes, people. The funny thing is with bourbon is the production most of the time starts with a mash, a sour mash, which is, to my notes, mixing some older, already fermenting batch with some... Okay, I can't make notes, kids. Don't be like me. But yeah, I was reading and it just doesn't make sense anymore. But yeah, what was I talking about? Oh yes, yeah, whiskey's not really good for your memory, kids. The whole sour mash thing. So, with whiskey they don't do this. Bourbon they do. They mix some of the newer fermenting batch with some older stuffies, and well then they go and distill and make some of this good stuff. Oh my god! Okay. Yeah, well, there's also a funny little thing, which I remember is the bourbon spirit cannot be distilled at any lower than 80% ABV, 160 proof. You also see this proof popping up every now and again, especially on bourbons. Well, what is it? Well, it's basically just the American way of saying ABV. And the way you can calculate the proof on the hand of the ABV is just by doubling it. 40% ABV, 80 proof. 36% ABV, 72% proof. And you will not find it. The minimum proof is 80 because it is 40 ABV. Get it? So, the other thing is, well... It can also not be distilled higher than 62.5 out of the top of my head. I'm not really sure, but I am probably sure because it's me. I'm always right. Yeah, well, oak barrels are the same. Oh yes, the whole straight bourbon thing. Well, what have I in my notes here? Yes, 2 years. I thought it was actually one, but it's two. So, if you want your bourbon to be called straight, you need to age it for a minimum of 2 years, kids. So, yes, the rules around bourbon are... I don't want to say looser, because, well, you cannot add color. If you want straight, you need to age it for 2 years. You see a lot of straight bourbons these days, especially Kentucky straight bourbons. Those are also the good ones in most of the times. Yeah, well, I think that was about it. Can you actually blend a bourbon? Yes, you can. Sure, why not? Just throw two together. As long as the spirit of the mix, so the end result is 51%, so 102% proof. Yes, and well, for the funny reason, I don't know what reason, but when you have blended a bourbon, you can add color, you can add flavor stuffies to it. You can do it. They don't care. Don't know why they don't. So yeah, that's that. Oh yes, almost forgot. You also have a Tennessee whiskey. Well, what is that? Well, let me get it. 1 second. Don't fall, don't die. Not like last episode. Bam! That's Tennessee whiskey for ya. Goo old Jack Daniels. Old number 7. I also have single barrel, but that is empty. Well, what's the difference? You go away. So, there we go. Yes. What's the difference? They are identically the same. Except one thing. In order to let your bourbon be called Tennessee whiskey, it, well, I think, actually, I never thought about it. It has to be made in Tennessee? I don't know. Probably is the case. But the most important thing, it needs to be charcoal mellowed. The way that is done is just by lowering the whiskey down to a big vat of charcoal, which filters the whiskey. Charcoal has a filtering effect to things that go through it. It can filter water, it can filter... It can actually cure diseases on some animals. Charcoal is really interesting stuff, especially as it's burned wood, you know? So, that's the whole thing. Charcoal mellowed. So, yeah, it also says it right here. And, well, there is actually one big Tennessee whiskey manufacturer, which is Jack Daniels. If you like bourbon, I highly recommend trying out Jack Daniels. I really like it. It's not that expensive. It is a little bit more expensive than bourbon most of the time. Depends on what bourbon you get. But in my opinion, it's worth it. The charcoal mellowing. You can definitely taste it. You can definitely experience it. And it's good. But this one is the star of the show tonight. Because that is what I have in my glass here at the moment. I have added about half a teaspoon to a quarter of a teaspoon of water. I have been, letting it sit in the glass for the, well, whole entire video. So I don't know how long that is. Probably about 15 minutes or so. And the nose, well, it has lost that coolness that I talked about in the previous video. I think it was the previous video, was it? Yes, probably. I'm wearing the same shirt. So yes, that must have been the previous one. Yeah. And well, it has not really gained anything in the nose. It has just lost that coolness and it got a little bit more rounded and it opened up a little bit more. It's just wider in particular. Taste-wise, it has lost the awful note at the end. I think that's actually the corn, though. But it was really intense without water. And, well, that's the alcohol for you. Most of the time, people look at the strength of a whiskey before they buy it. Why is it? Not because it has more alcohol, you can get drunk faster. It's because alcohol contains the flavors and the aromas that the cask puts into the spirit. So, yeah, a higher ABV does most of the time mean the whiskey will actually be more complex, more flavorful, has a better nose. Not all the times, there are exceptions, but that's why cask strength or barrel proof or barrel straight or I don't know what the people are calling it these days, are so popular. It still has that intensiveness which I encountered before, so I'm going to add a little bit more, about a quarter teaspoon extra, so we now have about a whole teaspoon of water in here. I hope I didn't drown it, because it only has 47% ABV, but it got a lot better. Score wise, we were probably about 8. Let's say 7.5. It was a little bit too intense in the mouth for me to really pull out some of the flavors, etc. Ooh, you can definitely sense the corn in there now. I believe that's the corn indeed, yes. It now reminds me of corn instead of a really metallic note. Definitely a good nose. Aged. You can definitely sense that this one has been aged, and for instance, this one is not. This one is, I don't know how old, probably 3 years or something. I don't know. This one is 12 years old, and it's good. At least the nose department is really good. But yeah, well, I talked about the whole differences. There also is rye whiskey. You see rye a lot in the bourbon market. So, yeah, but you see it a lot in Canada, by the way. Canadian club, etc. Canadians love their rye whiskeys. Rye is really difficult to explain, etc. There are rules and etc. etc. But let's be fair, the two main competitors in the whiskey market are bourbons and scotches. So, yes. Really pleasant and full caramel, honey, vanilla nose. Oh, nice, it's good. It's not the sweet kind of caramel, vanilla, etc. The ones you get at your local sweet store. Or out of a bag of Haribo. No, this is proper. I think I might hit the sweet spot. It's still intense in the mouth, but it's not overwhelming anymore. I can now get to all the different flavors and all the different notes in there. It's complex. Now the aftertaste has indeed changed. It still is kind of that same note, but that whole metallic, alcoholic note probably is gone. It's rounded now. And yes, I could say that's definitely the corn, in my opinion. In combination with the oak, it gets a lot of depth. I will definitely re-review this one in a week, maybe, when I have a little bit more time with this. I will definitely be spending time with this. And I am definitely intrigued to try more bourbons. Woodford Reserve, I have on my to-test list. But yes, well, if you have any questions about the whole bourbon scotch thingy-majigger, then leave it down in the description. In the comments, I should say. The description is my department. Yeah, well, the most important things again. Well, bourbon needs to be distilled in the USA. Scotch, Scotland. This one needs to contain a 51% corn. This one needs to contain malted barley. I don't know a specific amount. So, there may be, may not be. I don't think so. This one, Scotch, needs to be aged for at least 3 years in oak barrels. This one, well, doesn't need to do that. Except when you want to call it straight. If you want to get your bourbon to be called Kentucky, well, you need to distill it in the country of Kentucky a county? I don't know. You need to distill it in Kentucky. Whether there's a rule about maturing in Kentucky to be called Kentucky straight bourbon, I do not know. There are always exceptions and loopholes everywhere around rules. So yeah, but it's not up to us to really know that kind of stuff. That's more of the lawyer department. We just need to know where it comes from, etc., etc. Also, and the most important thing, bourbon is always naturally colored, except blended bourbon. And blended bourbon always needs to be 51%. So if they say blended bourbon, and well, it doesn't have 51% or 102% proof. Not a blend. Or they're illegal. That's also a case. But I don't think that they are. Ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for watching. I will be finishing this dram. There is definitely a sweet spot regarding this one. When it goes down, it gives you a little kick, which I almost died to in the last video. But man, with the right amount of water. To be fair, I didn't have a lot of bourbon to begin with. But there is definitely a sweet spot here. Definitely. Mark-wise, I'm just going to say it now. I think I will be giving it a 9. Because it's really complex and dark and deep. It has depth. And, well, I am about 2 drams into the bottle. So, yeah, I think there will be a lot more to explore, but this is, in my opinion, a really good bourbon, so I will be giving it a 9. There are some rough edges, maybe, but that's why I'm giving it a 9, not a 10. The way I rate bourbons or whiskeys in general is just, are they good? Could have the distillers do a better job? What would I like to see changed, etc., etc. If everything is just perfect and just plain old bloody good, it's a 10. Well, and we go from there on out. If it's just awful, a 5, of course. And when it's just decent, you know, probably a 6. So, yeah, you can kind of guess how that works, I think. But, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for watching. I hope you leave a like. In the future, I will, of course, make a lot more of these type of videos. I will also make a video regarding distillery introductions. So, I will make a video talking about Balvenie Distillery. I will make a video talking about Jack Daniel's Distillery. And I will, of course, make another video calling about... talking about Elijah Craig. I have already talked about Elijah Craig, but then I will show some pictures, talk really in depth about some more whiskeys or bourbons that Elijah Craig has to offer and whether they're hard to get price wise, that kind of stuff. I will be doing that. So yeah, well, I hope you liked it. If so, leave a like. If you don't, go away. And, I thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Goodbye, ladies and gentlemen.